Good morning. Welcome to Brookings United Church of Christ. Good to see you all here this morning, as well as those who are joining us on Facebook Live this morning. And just wanted to start our worship service this morning with a few things Peggy's going to share with us this time.
Once again, good morning. The cause of the month this month is it's Pride Month, and we will be having a booth at the Pride Festival on the 22nd. There will be more information coming on that next week. Farmers Market, we are having a booth at the Farmers Market this summer. There are sign-up sheets on the offering table for the different dates. If you're able to help out, that's great. Even if you're unable to work, come out and get some donuts and a glass of lemonade. You are invited to a birthday celebration. Don Jones and Phil Nafsinger will be hosting an open house celebration for Marilyn's 90th birthday, Sunday, June 16th, from 2 to 4 at the Irwin American Legion Hall. Come out and help Marilyn celebrate and see where some of our congregation disappears on the first Sunday of the month. The sign-up sheet for June worship leaders and fellowship help are on the offering table. And just a reminder, if you would like to support the church, our offering plate is on the table, and you can also do an ACH transaction or through tithely.com. Coffee and Conversation is on Tuesdays from 10:30 to 11:30 at the downtown location of Cottonwood Coffee. And Something to Chew On is Wednesdays, beginning at 6:30 with a potluck, and everyone is welcome to join. Birthdays this month were Nicholas Ward the 1st and Callista Kramer on the 6th. Are there any other announcements that need to be made?
All right. Thanks, Peggy. So I'm going to invite you all to stand at this time as we sing, as we've sung a few different times, so this shouldn't be a new song to you. It's a Chris Tomlin song, How Can I Keep From Singing? And Rachel's going to lead us into our worship this morning.
Storms may come, I am holding on to.
please remain standing for the call to worship.
Please join me in the responsive call to worship. We gather together in the name of Jesus who bids us to come.
We gather together to hear his message of love and grace.
We gather together to sing praises to Christ who teaches his disciples.
We gather together as his church passed down to us through the ages.
We gather together holding fast to our most meaningful and faithful traditions.
Come, let us worship together. Please take this moment to greet your neighbors this morning. You may be seated. So this is the time each week when we offer up a time to lift up joys and concerns, things we want to celebrate as a church family, and things we want to ask for prayers from our brothers and sisters as well. So Peggy has a microphone. If you have something to lift up this morning, if you want to raise your hand, she will find you with a microphone. Not all at once now, though that would be rude. So, okay, Beth, over here. Yeah, thank you.
I had a call from a friend yesterday who had fallen and broken her hip, and apparently they can't fix it. So she's just going to be in nursing care until she feels well enough to go home.
What's the name? Her first name?
Her first name's Ruth. Ruth, okay.
And Mary and Lisa.
We mentioned Dawn and Marilyn having her birthday, but Dawn and Phil are still on that big long trip, so keeping them in prayer and I'd like to lift up my daughter-in-law and son who have a new baby and babies. I don't know. Having a rough week.
It's not easy the first time around. And you don't know what you're doing. And there's no, well, there are books to tell you what to do, but, you know, they're not. It's not real. It's not real. Yeah, Mary.
Well, I have a joy. Some of you may know that my family spans 11 time zones. And the people from both ends, Finland and Alaska, my two sons, are both coming, and we will also join some relatives in Omaha, which is the Midwestern family I have. The rest is scattered around, so it'll be a real joy to have them with me. And I won't be here next week because we're going to Omaha then.
All right. Well, blessings and safe travels.
Safe travels.
Yes. Others. All right. If not, let's come to the Lord in a moment of silent prayer. And I will lead us into the Lord's Prayer. Awesome and loving Creator God, we lift up to you the prayers and joys that were spoken aloud, as well as those prayers from our hearts which you've received through the power of the Holy Spirit. Lord, and we lift up those who are in need of your healing touch this week, and as well as those who are traveling. We continue to pray for mercies and safe travel, as well as those who will be joining family and celebrating get-togethers, and those so often gatherings, Lord, as well as what we do here in worship on Sunday mornings are based around so often the things that our forefathers and mothers have done and we've learned to do as well, even the expressions of lifting up calls to worship and singing songs of praise and hymns and the prayers that we lift up together to you, God, as well as the sharing of Scripture, Lord, and these traditions. We thank you for the ways that we've indwelled them into our way of life, and we just thank you for the opportunities to come together and continue to live out those things that our ancestors have put before us, Lord, that we continue to come together and celebrate as your people, God. And so I lift up all of these things, as well as those people and situations that are on your heart, God, that we maybe have not lifted up this morning. We pray for the things that you pray for, God, and we want to walk in the way that you guide us and lead us through the power of your Holy Spirit. And so I pray all these things in the name of Jesus, the one who taught us to pray as we pray together, a contemporary form of his prayer as we say it together. Our Creator God, who reigns in heaven, holy be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As we sing this next hymn together, number 381, in some hymnals you recognize this tune as A Faith of Our Fathers. In the UCC hymnal, this has been, you know, retranslated a little bit into the wording of Faith of the Martyrs. But as you read that word, and as we sing this together, remember that we often equate that word martyr for someone who has died for the faith, but that word actually means witness. It means witness. The word martyr means witness. So we're singing to the ones who have witnessed to the faith before us. So let's sing together hymn number 381.
True.
Let us join together in our unison prayer this morning, both in your bulletins as well as on the screens before us. Lord God, Jesus said he came that we might have life and have it abundantly. We praise you and we thank you for his purpose in coming. And we pray to you that we might indeed experience the fullness of the life he has promised. Take from us, O Lord, all those things that get in the way of our relationship with you, our pride and self-certainty, our doubt and our fear, all those things that come from our human nature that bind us to the wonders of your presence and the glory of what you are doing in our midst. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, you know very well how our traditions and our understandings can become instruments of judgment rather than tools of your grace. We pray today, O God, for all those who have been hurt by our thoughtlessness, insistence that our particular way is the only right way. Touch the hearts of those who have turned away from you because we have caused your light within us to grow dim. We pray that you would brighten our souls. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, we thank you for the refreshing wind of your Spirit, for how you breathe into us new life and new hope and lead us to new understandings. In you we find wholeness for both body and soul. We pray now, O God, that this wholeness may not only grow within us, but that it might enter into and transform the lives of all your children. We lift them up, O Lord, along with your church, whom you have built upon throughout the ages. Let us, as your contemporary church, hold on to the most sacred of our traditions, while letting those which are divisive or no longer relevant be cast aside as far as the east is from the west. We pray all these things, O God, in the name of Christ Jesus, our Lord and our Savior, our brother and our friend. Amen. And at this time, Rachel is going to share with us a song by Elevation Worship, and it's entitled Same God. This song speaks to how the God who existed before the first scriptures were written, the God who existed during the intertestamentary period, and the God who exists with us here in this sanctuary today is the same God yesterday, today, and always. Thank you, Rachel. The scripture I'd like to share with you all today is from the letter of Colossians that the Apostle Paul wrote to the people in the village of Colossae. It's chapter 2, verses 8 through 23. In the NIV translation, it says this: "See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the elemental spiritual forces of this world rather than on Christ. For in Christ all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form, and in Christ you have been brought to fullness. He is the head over every power and authority. In him you were also circumcised with the circumcision not performed by human hands. Your whole self ruled by the flesh was put off when you were circumcised by Christ, having been buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through your faith in the working of God, who raised him from the dead. When you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all our sins, having canceled the charge of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us. He has taken it away, nailing it to the cross. And having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. Therefore, do not let anyone judge you by what you eat or drink, or with regard to a religious festival, a new moon celebration, or a Sabbath day. These are a shadow of the things that were to come. The reality, however, is found in Christ. Do not let anyone who delights in false humility and the worship of angels disqualify you. Such a person also goes into great detail about what they have seen. They are puffed up with idle notions by their unspiritual mind. They have lost connection with the head, from whom the whole body, supported and held together by its ligaments and sinews, grows as God causes it to grow. Since you died with Christ to the elemental spiritual forces of this world, why, as though you still belong to this world, do you submit to its rules? Do not handle, do not taste, do not touch. These rules, which have to do with the things that are all destined to perish with use, are based on merely human commands and teachings. Such regulations indeed have an appearance of wisdom with their self-imposed worship, their false humility, and their harsh treatment of the body, but they lack any value in restraining sensual indulgence." So this morning I'm in week number 2 of a 4-week series I'm entitling Scripture, Tradition, Experience, and Reason. And as was noted, this particular phrase was coined first by an American theologian and philosopher named Albert Outler. And in last week's sermon, we discussed the first element of this doctrinal framework, which is Scripture. And we noted how the 18th century pastor and professor John Wesley viewed Scripture as the primary source of information when asking questions of faith and Christian conduct. But he also used tradition, experience, and reason as additional resources to inform and elaborate upon what we read in Scripture. So today we're going to explore this second element of tradition. Now when we think of tradition in our personal lives, it may conjure up images of Thanksgiving or Christmas or Easter. We may have certain things that we do together as families. And some of them may have been dictated to an extent by our culture, and we may not even know why we even participate in them. Take, for example, setting up of the artificial or real Christmas tree within your home. How many of you actually know where this tradition came from? You can just raise your hand. Well, it actually began as a pagan ritual within the area of modern-day Germany. And even before the birth of Jesus, European Gauls decorated their homes with evergreen branches during the dark days of the winter solstice. And these ancient people believed that the sun was a god, and that winter came every year because the sun god became sick and weak. And they celebrated the solstice because it meant that at last the sun god would begin to feel well again. And these evergreen branches reminded them of all the green plants that would grow again in the spring when the sun god was strong and summer would return. And then a little over 3 centuries after the birth of Jesus, Christianity became legal in the Roman Empire, and the bishops of the church usurped this pagan tradition and began to institute it into the festival of Christmas. And the practice continued bringing evergreens into homes until the branches were eventually replaced by entire trees. So now you know the real reason for what you do during the Christmas season. But when it comes to traditions, the reality is sometimes we do things mainly because it's what our parents did, or it's what we were taught. Take, for example, the foods that you eat on Christian holidays like Christmas and Easter. Do you eat those foods because you really love them that much? Or do you do it because it's what your family has always done, as long as you can remember? There, of course, isn't any written rule that you have to eat those certain things, but we almost treat those meals like there is, right? And as we look back upon the life of Jesus and the era in which he lived, there were also many traditions that had been handed down by the Jewish people, not over only generations, but over millennia. And many of these traditions had no basis in following their ancient scriptures, but had become practices that they routinely followed. And these practices then became rules, and these rules then became basically elevated to the status of scripture. But Jesus didn't always follow these man-made rules, which had become tradition. Actually, he was somewhat of a rebel when it came to rules, but like it or not, they are all still around us today.
In a world full of rules, get to work on time, don't hold up the line, don't drive too fast, don't steal from the office, don't litter, put your shoes in the x-ray machine. Even when there are no rules, we make them up. Don't talk about money, tip the waiter, wear the right clothes, post your vacation pics, recycle, don't admit you watch that one show, you know the one. It happens everywhere. With our kids, our jobs, our friends, on TV, on the radio, the internet. But rules are mostly good, so what's the harm? What happens when the rules dictate how we do church? Go every Sunday, read your Bible, go to class, don't go to movies, watch your language, don't drink, gossip, judge. Ugh. What happens when we keep these rules? Pride, judgment. And what happens when we don't? Shame, lying. Do rules really save us or make us better? Or do we just like rules? Jesus wasn't hung up on keeping the rules. He was hung up on people's hearts. What are you hung up on?
What are you hung up on? This is, in essence, what the question the Apostle Paul was asking the church within the city of Colossae as he was writing this letter of Scripture today to them. In it, he says, "See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the elemental spiritual forces of this world rather than on Christ." So Jesus himself had conflicts with the Pharisees over their traditions. But Paul himself, as a Pharisee, sought to teach the people of Colossae the difference between what was of God and what was merely handed down through Jewish tradition. You see, the Pharisees had so much respect for the original set of scriptures that they wanted, and they wanted to protect them so desperately that they started adding to them. Then after a while, it seemed not only helpful to make additions, but absolutely essential. For instance, if God said we could not work on the Sabbath, then don't even pick up grain to eat. Just play it safe. And don't even heal people because that might be a borderline case. These traditions and additions accumulated into hundreds over the years. And soon it became apparent that they were far from optional. And by the 3rd century AD, they were standardized, actually, into a collection called the Talmud. And these laws became every inch as important as the scriptural laws, and in some instances, more crucial. The Pharisees also saw it as their mission to create new laws as the times changed. If they felt the scriptures contained no moral laws to control something modern, then they would manufacture a new law and announce that it was binding on humans and God. New situations could not be ignored. And if there were gaps in the scriptures, the priestly class would fill them in. But rather than focus on these negative aspects of the Jewish tradition, Wesley gave his attention to the more positive aspects of Christian tradition. In his book, John Wesley's Teachings, Professor Thomas Auden says that Wesley sought to present thoughts agreeable to what he termed Christian antiquity. The term antiquity, as Wesley used it, referred to the, quote, the religion of the primitive church, of the whole church in the purest ages, honoring ancient Christian writers and ecumenical documents of the first 5 centuries, was highly esteemed and valued by classic Anglican scholars, and Wesley was steeped in this tradition. He wrote, "We prove the doctrines we preach by scripture and reason, and if need be, by antiquity. No thinking person will easily dismiss and certainly never condemn the fathers of the church whose views are indispensably necessary for the practice of ministry. There is no excuse for one who has the opportunity and makes no use of it to fail to read the best patristic texts, the writings of the early church fathers." And Wesley elaborates further in writing, "The fathers are the most authentic commentators on scripture as being both the nearest to the fountain and eminently endued with the spirit by whom all scripture was given. I speak chiefly of those who wrote before the Council of Nicaea, but who would not likewise desire to have some acquaintance with those that followed them, with Saint Chrysostom, Basil, Jerome, Augustine, and above all, Ephraim Cyrus." So Wesley was quick to concede that the ancient Christian writers made occasional mistakes and many weak suppositions and many ill-drawn conclusions. "Nonetheless," he said, "I exceedingly reverence them as well as their writings because they describe true, genuine Christianity." He believed the serious reading of the church fathers is especially helpful at 2 decisive points: for the explication of a doctrine that is not sufficiently explained, or for the confirmation of a doctrine generally received. When Wesley appealed alternatively to reason, scripture, or authority, the authority of which he was speaking was the authority of the early ecumenical tradition. The ancient ecumenical creeds, such as the Apostles' Creed and the Nicene Creed, as well as the most classical Christian writings. He said these early apologists, meaning explanatory defenders of the faith, had the advantage of living in the apostolic times, of hearing the apostles and conversing with them. They had been chosen by them for their leadership in the nascent church. So we cannot with any reason doubt what they deliver, but ought to receive it, though not with equal veneration, yet with only a little less regard than we do the sacred writings of those who were their masters and instructors. But Wesley was never so presumptuous as to put himself on the same plane as these early writers, but he did seek to follow in their footsteps in regard to his desires to expound upon what he'd learned from Scripture and how it shaped him. He wrote works in 7 of the 8 foreign languages he knew, which included Hebrew, Greek, Latin, French, Dutch, Spanish, and Italian. He also published a general history of Christianity, a history of England, a library of Christian classics, a system of natural philosophy, a general commentary on Scripture, and considerable poetry and hymns, some in his own translation from the original Latin or Greek. So Wesley focused on the most insightful, instructive, and positive forms of tradition which upheld the new covenant with God as expressed through Jesus. But from the very beginning of the church in Colossae, the Apostle Paul was already condemning the required adherence to some former traditions. In our scripture, he says to them, "Since you died with Christ to the elemental spiritual forces of this world, why, as though you belong to the world, do you submit to its rules? Do not handle, do not taste, do not touch." These rules which have to do with things that are all destined to perish with use are based on merely human commands and teachings. So as I hear these words of Paul, it reminds me of how over the centuries some within the church have added more and more rules that have nothing to do with the mandates of Jesus and his gospel. Rules such as not playing cards, not dancing, not dressing up on Halloween, etc. And how we have a history of instituting traditions which are even contradictory to the cause of Christ. Practices such as the sale of indulgences, which was basically a bribery of priests for the absolution of sins, along with the sale or rent of church pews. We're glad we don't do that anymore, aren't we? These traditions represent some of the worst examples of manipulation within the church and have nothing to do with the tradition or Christian antiquity to which we hold dear. And these examples should serve as a call for us to carefully examine why we believe what we believe and why we do what we do within the church, because it might seem right at the time. In fact, Paul said in our scripture, "Such regulations indeed have an appearance of wisdom." But as we know from history, the church has not always been as wise as it believed it was. So as the church of the present and the future, may we hold on to the best of our traditions, and may we absorb the wisdom of our forefathers in the faith. The sacraments of baptism and of Holy Communion are just two examples within Scripture which aren't completely explored or defined, but through our church traditions, we have a better understanding of them. However, let us also hold on loosely to those traditions which have no foundation in the gospel, and even discard those that contradict it. When we seek answers in this way, within the church and within our personal lives, only then will we be faithful witnesses of the good news and wise builders of the kingdom. Amen. Would you pray with me? Gracious God, as we consider this morning the traditions that we follow personally within our families, as well as the traditions of our faith, which we follow as part of a church family. Lord, let us contemplate and consider where those traditions came from and why we continue to do them. And Lord, let us look to Jesus as one who held on to those traditions that were helpful and moved us forward as individuals in the faith and brought us together in community. But he also discarded and fought against those traditions that ended up dividing people and being divisive and causing judgment upon certain groups as well, Lord. So help us hold on to the best that our forefathers and mothers have taught us, and let us dispose of the rest and be ever mindful of Jesus through the process. In his name I pray. Amen. So at this time, I would invite you to stand once again, if you're able, as we sing our closing hymn this morning. Number 377, Forward Through the Ages. Benediction. As you go from this place, may we all move together forward through the ages, living out the best of our faith traditions through Jesus Christ our Lord, whom we pray. Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord.